Well, hello, this is Peter Combs from Bidamount.com and P.L. Combs Asian Art in Gloucester, Massachusetts. And today is December 4th, 2020, and this is our weekly video. We do one each week, take a look back and see how things did on our newsletter page. It's the page where we pick out things that we find on eBay and over on CATAWIKI that we share with our users and see how they did in the auction world over the last 7 days. And it was a pretty good week for everybody. They did well. One of the things I did want to mention was that earlier today we put up the video for the Hong Kong sales that took place earlier this week, covering mostly Christie's and Bonhams. But they had some nice results. It was interesting auctions, very interesting things, and covered some of the prices, covered a couple of the disappointments. But that's the auction world, you know, you get used to that. And now we're going to take a look here. A couple of things I wanted to mention was, let's see here, on the global member pages this week, we posted a whole bunch of things on here. We updated the page several times this week just because things kept coming and going. A lot of auction houses are clearing out, getting ready for the Christmas holidays into the new year. You're going to see fewer and fewer things after about the 17th of the month or so, because people on eBay don't want to be selling a lot of things and have to worry about shipping through the Christmas holidays. And international packages, particularly at this time of the year, are a pain in the neck to deal with. And the big auctioneers, the live auctioneers, are going to be doing a lot less too. But there are some nice things up there right now, and a couple of them I wanted to go through that are on the member pages. If you check the live auctioneers page, you're going to find this. This is a Codner sale coming up in 7 days. Is this very, very nice late 18th century side handle chocolate pot. It's a rare one. This is an unusual type. It's heavily gilded, beautifully done, nice export example with this beautiful pistol handle on it. And I like the Barry finial, and I love the way the spout is done with these gilt lines running out to it. It's a good looking pot. Of course, you always get a condition report, but the estimate is very low, and I don't know why. All right, it may be a condition problem, but it's worth checking out. It may have nothing wrong with it, and they're just trying to tell you it's going to sell. This is an auction house in Florida, in the United States. Joshua Codner, and on Dania Beach, Florida. All right, the estimate is $200 to $300. It should go well through that. This looks like an $800 to $1,200 pot, no matter what, unless it's been heavily restored. So check it out, get a condition report. You have plenty of time, and that's a nice thing. He's got some other good. If you're on the global pages, check out the rest of his sale. He's got some good Chinese export on there. And then this is at Christie's online. They have an online sale running right now. And I couldn't find out what's wrong with this. It has a Chait Gallery provenance. It's absolutely Kangxi period. And check this out. Check out the handles on this thing. These terrific looking, whoa, these terrific looking lizards climbing up over the side of it. This nice gilded dragon. It is 17 inches tall, and it has some sort of a fitting in. I think at one point in its life, there's the bottom. And I don't know if that sticker is covering up a hole or not. You want to maybe call them and find out about that, because the inside of it has some sort of a fitting, like it maybe was made into a table lamp, but they may not have drilled it. They may have just put this in there, affixed it somehow with glue, usually to the interior. And if it's glued in, you can probably get it out with a good dose of hot water and things, loosen the glue up and pull it out if you want to. But I love this vase, and I loved how they did this sort of cracked ice pattern with prunus blossoms. Or plum blossoms around the interior in green. Just a very attractive and interesting vase. And as I said, it's 17 inches tall, and the estimate on it, I think, is very reasonable. $800 to $1,200. If there's nothing wrong with this vase, that's a heck of a good buy. And this is being sold at Christie's New York. So the shipping, if you're in the U.S., shouldn't be that big of a deal. Maybe you just pick it up, get a friend to pick it up for you, if you don't want to worry about the shipping from their shippers because of the cost, maybe. But it's 18 inches tall. Check it out. It's worth checking out. Always worth checking it out. And the other painting is that Tremont Galleries here in Massachusetts, run by Jim Callahan. You may remember him. He's a friend of mine and his partner, another friend of mine, Brett Downer. They run Tremont. They're two very, very good dealers. They've been around together. You may remember Jim. He used to be on Roadshow all the time. He was at Skinner's for a number of years. He's a great guy. And they've got this painting. I think this is a great Chinese painting. I love this thing. It's a woman with her grandmother, and it looks like a daughter on a terrace scene underneath some very, very pretty weeping willows, late 18th, early 19th century painting. Lovely looking work. Nice looking painting. And They have a number of other things. They also have a lot of good Chinese export. And this painting is big. This thing is 56 inches long, wide. So it's 4 feet long and about a foot tall. So that's a heck of a thing. And the estimate's very reasonable. $1,500 to $2,000. I think it should go well through that. If you can buy it for that estimate, you're doing great. The sale is on Sunday. So check it out. If you call there, I know Brett and Jim pretty well. And if they're there, they'll answer the phone and talk to you about it. They love what they do. But this is just a dandy painting. Look at the brushwork in here, all the way the willow leaves are done. Just a nice thing. So check out the Tremont sale down in down south of here, down in Sudbury, Mass. Okay. And they'll arrange for shipping for you. They're dealers, so they'll treat you right if you buy something. They'll get it taken care of. Now, let's take a look over on the Bidamount newsletter page. Those of you that checked it out last week, I noticed a lot of clicks. I guess a lot of people liked it. Josh Chamberlain had a sale that closed on Monday that did quite well. And there was a lot of other material on there. And all of it seemed to get a lot of interest. And there were some great bargains on the Japanese side and on the Chinese side. And we're going to go through some of them. But the page was very full last week of things that we found that we put in here. And I think, again, it's dealers sort of doing some last bit of push business for the end of the year, and we're going to go through the prices right now. First thing I wanted to mention was this over on CATAWIKI was this very large. This thing was 76 centimeters tall, or about 32 inches tall in Western measure, in U.S. measurements. But it was a big piece of Meiji period bronze, nice example with a samurai on the top, and these very, very, very enthusiastic looking dragons going up the side, sort of overscale and sort of frame and dominate the scene very nicely. A beautiful looking thing. And it ended up selling for 750 euros, which I don't think is a bad price at all for that. That was a nice piece of bronze. Very nice. Excellent. And then over here to this was also on CATAWIKI. I noticed a lot of ivory turning up on there lately. I think the EU is really lightening up on the ivory laws, or they're just not enforcing anymore, because a couple of years ago, as many of you remember, there was a massive crackdown because of the poaching that was going on in Africa. And I think everybody came to their senses and realized that virtually none of the ivory being poached in Africa was being turned into, quote, antiques. It was being bought as an investment and so forth. Chinese government cracked down on it. The poaching, fortunately, has cut way back. And now I'm seeing antique ivories turning back up on the market in the EU particularly. I noticed eBay's less aggressive about taking them down. And maybe that's a trend. I don't know. But always check your local laws before you go shipping the stuff around the world. Now, back to this. This great-looking okimono with the demons around a lotus pot. There's this very muscular. I love the way they did the muscles on this guy. And then they stained it to highlight the piece. And this did pretty well. This ended up selling for, what did this sell for? Winning bid, 900 euros, which is pretty good. That's not an outrageous price, but it's a very fine one. And there were a whole bunch of other ivories on there as well. 900 euros for a good Japanese okimono. And then over to this. I pointed this out last week because I love the colors on this plate. I thought the color combinations were so successful on here with reds and tans. The color values are all sort of the same. So when you have colors on objects, understanding color values is very important, because you can put any color with any color as long as the values of the colors are the same. And that has to do with the tonality of the enamels and so forth, and the shading and the intensity, and those create your color values. And with those, you can use almost any combination of colors. And here you have these wonderful pomegranates with sort of an overall peach tones, and then light browns, and then this very nice grayish green. They call it a French gray sometimes in the West, but French green makes a wonderful wall color if you get it a little lighter. Anyway, this is a wonderful plate, and it had a later Chinese or European silver mount placed onto it, but a nice example, and flips around the back. Here it is, beautifully done. Let's see here, Kangxi period, and it ended up selling for, pretty reasonably, 340 euros. I think that was fine for that. That was a nice-looking plate and very unusual. The color palette on that was unusual. Loved it. And then over to this, the Kangxi footed little pot that we had featured. I just thought this was a wonderful form, sort of a rare form. They use a border pattern that you see on Kangxi dishes, and they just repeated it around the outside of it to band the piece. It did have a crack in the body, which I mentioned last week, and had, I think I said it had a line in the lid. Here's a picture of the top. The top of it was just beautifully painted. It was just absolutely wonderfully painted. There it is. Good, good colors. And it did pretty well at the end. It ended up selling for 998 euros, which is sort of in the range. I think we thought it would bring 800 to 1200 euros, somewhere around there, 900 to 1000. So you're right in there. And a nice unusual example. And then over here, this was on eBay. There were a couple of these silk rondelles on here. And they're always sort of an interesting barometer to judge the silk market, because these rondelles with dragons on them are so collected. They're like rank badges. People love them. They did them in many different varieties. This was a nice one, and it was done on a very dark blue background, which made the dragon stand out in a particularly nice way. And the dragon is very muscular looking. Very strongly done, and the scales on the dragon are particularly well done. And if you blow it up, you'll notice that they use several different sewing techniques in here to highlight the scales on the dragon, and then they shaded in sort of a rose colored with a pinkish color to do the lightning bolts around it. And you can just go across it and see that the whole thing actually was in quite good condition all the way around. I don't see a lot of pulls, I don't see any wears, I don't see any holes. Nice looking thing. And in the end, a lot of people liked it. It ended up selling for $1,646. But a nice 19th, early to mid 19th century example. They said it was an imperial silk embroidery. It's not imperial, okay? People throw around the word imperial a little too much. But it's top quality. It was a nice looking thing. And if one of you got it, you got a nice piece of silk on your hands. And then over to this. This was something that was misdated. I hope some of you noticed it. The seller usually, this is Trophy 01 over in Paris. Typically, they date things pretty accurately. And in this one, they were off, I think, by a considerable margin. They had it down as Republic period. And to my eye, this is not a Republic period vase. It's earlier than that. This nice satiny celadon glaze, these iron applied handles, and when you flip the thing over and you get a good look at the bottom, that's not your typical Republic period foot rim, but it's very typical of mid-19th century work and even a little bit older. I think this was older than the seller thought it was. It may have been just because it was in such good condition. But to me, this is a mid-19th century piece or older. I think it was a very nice one. And I think somebody got a great buy on it because it went for $440. And this thing was big, 17 inches, 41 centimeters tall. So it was about, how tall is that? That works out to about 16 inches in height, I guess, something like that. I think this was a terrific thing for somebody. That was one of the, as we say, the bargain of the week. Had he dated it more accurately and, you know, done it a little differently, it probably would have brought over $1,000. So I think that was a fabulous buy for someone. Very nice. And then over here to this. These were a pair of Ming style, but Republic period figures that Josh Chamberlain had up. He had them as 20th century, which they clearly are. But they were beautifully done. They were 17 inches tall, extremely decorative. They were handsome. All right, here's a picture of the base. All right, very typical Republic period work. Here's a picture of the backs. Very nicely done. And as you can see by the water bottle that he threw in the middle there, these are big. And in the end, they did pretty well. They brought $1,775. They got a lot of interest because they were so pretty. Everybody knew they weren't Ming, but because if they were Ming, they would have brought, you know, 20,000, 30,000. But beautifully done, nice quality. And then over here to this, Joshua also had this up. This was a very pretty apple green jade carved pendant with, it looks like, diamonds and platinum mounts. 20th century work, but very finely done, very pretty piece of jade. And everybody loved it. At the end, it went for $4,138. Nice Christmas gift for somebody. All right. And he also had this up. We talked about this because I liked the bowl a lot. And I liked how they did the Edwardian sort of silver on here. But this is a late Ming bowl with reticulated walls. And they did the walls, as you can see, with alternating with a honeycomb and then a fish scale pattern, which made them sort of interesting. Here's a nice picture of the bottom of it. The silver was hallmarked. I can't make out what that is, but it's probably early. It looks like early 20th century, late 19th century silver. But a heck of a nice little bowl. And it did fine. It brought $1,426, right on the money. And then over here to this very nice Lang Yao or Song De Boeuf 18th century pot. I don't think it was necessarily Kangxi, but I do think it was a late 18th century, maybe early 19th century. It's very hard to tell with these because they were able to make them so well. But the shape and the glazes and everything, to me, looks 18th century. And it's beautifully done and ended up selling for $2,247. And this thing was of not enormous size, but it was good size, 37 centimeters. Some of these, as you know, can get quite large. But 37 centimeters is about 14 or 15 inches, 16 inches, I guess. Good size pot, $2,247. And I don't think that was an overpayment at all. I think that was a good price. And I always say, and I know you all know it, but you know, leave a bid on things, especially for things like that green celadon vase. If you see something on eBay too, another thing you can do is if you see something on there, take it and run it over and throw it up on the forum and on the Bidamount page and ask the users over there, Mark and the gang over there, they some smart guys over there, they know what they're doing. I follow it. I don't often comment on it because I don't want to stick my nose in everywhere all the time, but I do read what they're saying and what they're up to over there, and they have some good conversations on the forum. And if you have something you're not sure about, they're a nice bunch, and they'll help you with things as much as they can. All right, and they do know what they're doing. All right, now on to this, the silver tankard, the dragon tankard. I thought this was a good one. I talked about it last week. I thought this would do pretty well. I love the dragon on it. He's almost cartoonish looking. He looks like the way the face is done, it almost looks like the way they did cartoons in the 1930s, the early Disney studios, I think. It was just sort of interesting how it was done. And in the end, it took off. It did well. It brought $1,875. This was the seller Digger Studio here in Massachusetts had this up. He gets nice. He gets good things. He gets good things. And then over here to the bronze with the mirror mounted on the back of it. This was a nice thing. We talked about it last week. I liked the surface on it. I think it was either late Ming or early Qing, but very nice quality all the way around. It had a later stand, of course, probably from the early 20th century. And in the end, it did fine. It brought $5,100, but a desirable type and an unusual type because the mirror on the back lifts off. So it's removable. So it's sort of a convertible thing. And that makes it interesting. And then these, the Republic Famille Rose pots. I liked these a lot. I thought the decoration on them was splendid. I liked all the little details. I liked all the little precious objects. I thought the enameling was just tip-top on them. It was very well done. And these weren't enormous. These were 6 or so inches, 7 inches tall each. And in the end, they did really well. A lot of people like these, and they're very pretty. And this was Digger Studio. Again, they brought $2,226. Which is fine. They're very, very pretty. They're a pair. And I hope if one of you bought them, put a plant in them. God, they look gorgeous with the appropriate plants on them. And just so you know, a little secret about these is that in China, around the Imperial Palace, if they had a chrysanthemum, a vase with chrysanthemums on it, what the vase was decorated with was often used as a guide to what kind of plants or flowers would be put in them. So that the flowers coming out of the vase would mirror what's decorated onto the vase if it's a florally decorated vase. All right, so if you have a flower vase and it's got flowers on it, see what kind of flowers are on there and try to match them. It looks really nice. It looks really nice. If you have flower vases, put flowers in them. I don't care how old the vase is, use it. And if you have a planter, put a plant in it, okay? They look silly sitting in a cabinet like a display. Put them out. Let them be part of your life. And 2226. And then over here to this was this very nice Kosometsuki Wan Lee dish here with the pine tree in the middle. Nice type, nice style. Had a couple of very, very minor frits on the edges from the firing. But other than that, this plate was in wonderful condition. Beautiful, deep, dark cobalt blue. Nice color. And it brought $260. I think somebody got an outstanding buy with this. Really outstanding. I think this was an absolutely great buy. And this plate wasn't tiny. It was about 6 inches in diameter or something like that. See if he's got the dimensions here. 147 centimeters. Yeah, about 6 inches. Okay. And now over to this. Was that 19th century bowl with the Kangxi mark on it, or they ascribed it as Kangxi style? It wasn't. It was 19th century, but beautiful quality. This was Migliari had this. He had a whole lot of stuff up last week. Here's a picture of the bowl. I think the flowers were nicely done. Here's a picture of the base. Here's a picture of the interior. Just a good-looking bowl. And $406 or £301. Perfectly reasonable. Nice-looking piece of porcelain. All right, and then on to this was that big Famille Rose medallion jar. We talked about this last week. I talked about it because I thought it was so attractive. And it was decent size. It was in good condition. How big was this thing? What was it, like 15 inches or something? 17 inches. This was a big pot. And last week when we were looking at it, I don't know, what is that, $400 or $500 or something. And I thought it would bring $900 to $1,200 anyway, just because they always do. It's big. It's got a nice presence to it. And the quality is better than many of them. And it was probably done about the middle 19th century from what I can see of the decoration. Here are the side panels with all the flowers, maybe 1840, something like that. Here's a picture of the bottom of it, you know, the way they all look, sort of that oatmeal-toned paste and, you know, a fair bit of it exposed. You know, very nice. Here's the picture of the inside of the lid. It wasn't broken, which is a miracle because the lids on these always seem to be broken and then glued back together. But anyway, it went for $1,376, which I think is perfectly reasonable, and a handsome jar and big. All right, and then over here to the cross. This was that very interesting mother of pearl inlaid cross. This was the one, if you remember, we talked about it last week because it had this rather nice cup done onto it with Chinese elements carved into it, with this pattern here, this wave pattern that you see around the rims and the edge rims and the foot rims of bowls and vases. And just a nice looking thing. And I think this went pretty reasonably because a lot of times these come up and they bring $1,500, $1,800, $2,000. This one went for just $995. And the Christian community and art of Christian workmanship is a very interesting area to study with regards to China. As a matter of fact, the PBD Museum a few years ago, maybe 10 years ago now, it's been a while, maybe longer, they did an exhibition on Christian religious representation in Chinese art. And it was pretty interesting. It was done by Corinna Kerrigan and Bill Sargent did it together. Years ago, two great people, very bright. And now over to this. This was another silk dragon roundel. This one was in a gold frame. This was Richwood Fine Arts had this. This is a nice looking roundel, and I like the frame on it. It's a good way to preserve it, to keep it from fading. You never want to put these silks in the sun, but if there's a lot of light in the room, a little bit of glass to help filter the UV, especially if you get UV-proof glass, really helps. All right, and this was a nice, nice example. Good, crisp, clean colors. Late Qing Dynasty, probably Guangxu period. Ended up selling for $2,125. And then popping over to this. This was one of these things. These desk sets are sort of curious. It's a whole world unto themselves. There were a number of companies. Dexter in New York did them, and Yamanaka Company did them. And they would take Chinese bits and mount them. And this one, they used rose quartz and put them on this very attractive European sort of style brass stand. And you notice up here, if you didn't notice it, I hope you did, because whoever bought it's going to make some good use of that. This nice piece of jadeite, it's a jadeite bracelet that was turned into a frame for the clock. And I think somebody got a good buy on this. That was the money right there. The birds were nice. The birds standing by themselves, or they were being sold, would bring $200 or $300. The metalwork is quite good, but that jade ring is quite exceptional. And somebody picked it up for $730. A handsome thing. But converting, using Chinese objects and putting them into Western desk objects was a very fashionable thing to do in the United States, especially back between 1915, 1920, and right up to the beginning of World War II. And in New York, there were a number of companies in particular that did this. They did it in Boston at Yamanaka. They would get old lamp finials and bits and pieces, and they would repurpose them into interesting table objects like this. And every once in a while, you come across one. I have one that I gave my wife years ago that was very nice. Still has it. All right, and then over here to this very lovely piece of silk with the Fu lions on it. I like that an older and a younger Fu lion, she's sort of lecturing him as they go along. And this nice, soft silk background. And it's, you know, the tonal, what's interesting about this is that the color ranges used on this are only, even with the shades of gray, there's only about two or three on here. And there's a tiny, 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 tiny bit of pink up here in the bird's beak and maybe somewhere else on the nose of the Fu lion. But this shows you, with good stitching and using different stitching techniques, the effects that can be created by a highly skilled silk weaver. This is a real, real study in just how effective they can be just by changing the way they would sew into the silk, and how they would pattern it, how thick they would make it, and the different styles that they used. This was a good piece. And it ended up doing pretty well. It brought $1,349, but nice, very nice piece of silk, and it was 19th century. And this was Nafisa. He's a seller over in Kent, the UK. He's been getting better and better things lately, too, which is sort of interesting. We'll keep an eye on him. And then over here to this, the Nyonya Straits silk textile for the Straits community in Asia. This was a beautiful piece. Very typical, bright colors, strong, festive colors, very happy, bright oranges and this beautiful shade of blue that they used on. See if I can get a better picture of it. This blue tone that you see in here, and these nice rose colors, this beautiful chain stitching around the outside of the flowers. Then they would frame it. And all this, and Nyonya Straits silks have gotten very, very popular over the last few years, in particular, in the last 10 years, especially. And this one brought $1,465. It was a nice, nice thing. It would be a good hanging. It was decent size. It was 92 centimeters long and 33 centimeters wide, so it was over 3 feet long and over 1 foot wide, so it would look great on a wall, you know, in your dining room or somewhere. Just don't, again, hang it in the sun anyplace, because that will be the end of it in about a month. All right, and then over here, again, on CATAWIKI, this, as far as bronzes go, was the buy of the week. This pair of nice Meiji period bronzes, these offering bronzes, there they are. Nice wave borders, very well cast, interesting to look at, nicely done. The pair, and they were good size too. These weren't little. These were 39 centimeters tall, so they were about 18 inches tall each. Went for just €220. So if you saw them and you were thinking of buying them, you should have left a bid, because you never know what the guy's last dollar was on it. Whoever bid on it might have been €221. All right, and then over here to this. This was something else that Josh had up. This very nice piece of Satsuma. Very finely done, four-sided, top-notch quality, later 1870s, 1880. But the details on this were really good. I hope, if you're a Satsuma buyer, I hope you took the time to look at this beautifully done pot. Absolutely wonderful. Signed on the bottom. Look at that. God, is that good work. Wow. And look at the price. $1,475. There you go. That's a good deal. That's a lovely piece of Satsuma for $1,400. Satsuma, like all the Japanese stuff, is still, I think, woefully underappreciated. This was a wonderful example. And if you're a collector, you're thinking of taking up collecting fine, high-quality Satsuma, it's been a heck of a good time to do it for about the last 8 years. Just a wonderful example. And then over here to this was the other thing that Josh had, was this very nice Kangxi charger. It went for $1,825, and it was decent size. It was 15 inches across and has some minor nicks or something to it, but a very attractive plate with this swirl pattern. These are done, a little bit of molding. Sometimes they molded them a bit, and then they did it with chrysanthemums and pine trees alternating around the outer border. And there's a nice picture. He always does good pictures. Here's a nice picture of the back with the artisma leaf on it and an old French storage warehouse label on there. Those are always good to see. And it did $1,825, which was fine. That was a perfectly good price. It could have brought more. And then on to this. This was, I think, a very nice buy. This wasn't an enormous plate, but it was a very fine Kangxi example with overglazed blue enameling, and then these nicely spaced floral elements on the flattened diverted rim. And let's see if we can get some more pictures in here. There you go. better shot of the interior, and the interior is done in enamels with that sort of quick pencil sketch that they would use around it. There you go. Nice looking thing. And this sold reasonably, I think. $235. How can you beat that? 235 euros, excuse me. And that was it. All right. So thank you for watching. If you enjoy the videos, give us a thumbs up, leave a comment, subscribe to us here on YouTube, come over to bidamount.com and use the newsletter page. We're all here, and check out the new video. We just put it up today. All right. Have a wonderful weekend, and we'll see you next week. Bye-bye.